I have the opportunity to introduce the next teller, and I'm introducing that teller because it's going to be Marianne Moorman, or Aunt Mama, who you've seen little bits of so far. I have known Marianne for more than 10 years. People fall into categories for me of people I've known less than 10 years and people I've known more. I don't really pay attention after that. So it's more than 10 years for Marianne. I have known her as a business professional, as a poet, as an arts organizer, and as a storyteller. And in all of those iterations, I always appreciate what she brings. Please join me in welcoming Aunt Mama to the stage.
My family's ancestry tree begins with Thomas. Thomas was a carpenter, a simple man, a handsome, rugged man who could feel the wood in his hand and knew what to do with it. And his wife, Rachel, a bit more genteel, a little more refined, the daughter of a ship captain who had brought to her a harpsichord to their home in Williamsburg. The two fell in love. But the problem was that Thomas was a Quaker boy, and Quakers could hear the rattling of swords, the red coats from the king, and they watched the slave ships come in with men who were going to go and give their lives to the plantations. And that is also against the Quaker faith. So Thomas convinced Rachel to cross the mountains, to go into the forest, into the woods. And the history of our musical tree begins when he built that cart for the harpsichord. And with several slaves who were very carefully hidden under the floorboard in the wagon with the food, they packed two children, everything they owned, crossed Afton Mountain, which is, think about like going from Jamestown to southwestern Virginia. And when they got to a switchback, going over, the cart breaks. The harpsichord is destroyed. Thomas salvages what he can. He gets the strings. He gets woods. He gets part of the ivory. He gets every shard that he can. And he promises Rachel he will make her a harpsichord. Well, it took so much longer to get to the big valley than anyone thought it was going to. It was getting to be cold at night. And Juba May was having a baby. She was getting bigger by the day, and she was scared, a little scared, because runaway slaves were scared. They trusted Thomas and Rachel almost, but she was having a baby. She was maybe 16. This was all very new, and so they had to stop. And they built a camp with their wagons and some lean-tos with the other immigrants who were coming from Pennsylvania and coming from Maryland, and they all gathered by the Shenandoah River to pass the winter. They shared their stories. They shared their food. They shared their skills. And they shared their music. The McGees, the Scotch and the Irish, brought their fiddles and their fifes. And Ms. McGee had nothing to it. If you don't have a song in your ear, you're going to have the devil in your heart, she'd say. So we might as well sing. And at night, there was music, and it lifted everyone's spirits. But whenever they played, Rachel had a ghost at her fingertips and no harpsichord. So Juba took three strings from the harpsichord, and he strung them across a gourd. And Stuart Brune will come join me. And I'll tell you how these three strings and a deer skin and a water gourd became a strum-strum, which today we call a banjo. Juba loved that strum-strum, and everybody else loved it. Juba May was just a little scared, and Rachel was tired and oh, so lonesome out there without her family. Well, Moses played the strum, and he played for Juba May to lift her spirits, and he played for the child that was going to be born, a free child, and they were going west and raise their families all together. Well, it was hard. Moses, McGee, Thomas working out all day, looking for food, chopping wood to keep everybody warm. Rachel was trying to help Juba May, trying to get food, learning how to cook what they killed and they caught. And then it was night, and they'd play music. He'd strum that strum. Rachel would play her ghost keys. And Thomas said to McGee, I wish I could build her that harpsichord. And McGee looked at him, thinking of the practicality of having a harpsichord in the Shenandoah Valley. No, I'll teach her how to do the fiddle. I'll teach her how to bow. And he tried to teach her how to bow, but Rachel didn't like the bow. She said she wanted to touch the strings. McGee went and got Thomas and said, you have these tools, you have this wood, build her a guitar. Oh, well, Thomas didn't know anything about guitars. Guitars weren't just quite an instrument in the 1700s. There was a big cistern and kind of hammered and keys, and there was this English-looking kind of things, but they had this strum. This is what they played, and Thomas and McGee got together, and Moses figured he could make anything happen with music, and so they took charcoal, and they drew pictures, and they looked at the fiddle, and they tried to remember what they had seen other people do. And then Thomas got maple wood, and he planed it. He planed it thin. And Moses and McGee went and got hickory, and they cut pegs, and they used the fiddle as an example of what that might look like. And Thomas was fashioning it all together. And then one night, it was so cold, and the snow was coming, and it just lay across the valley like a bridal gown. Rachel was tired. She couldn't keep the children satisfied. She couldn't keep Juba May calm. And whenever the children came out to the tool shed, well, Moses, McGee, and Thomas were like, see no evil, hear no evil, and speak no evil, because it was a secret. They didn't want anybody to know that they were trying to make a guitar. The one who wanted to know the most was Christopher. Christopher watched his father touch the wood. Christopher touched the tools, and he wanted to learn. And as soon as Thomas saw Christopher coming, he'd send him back in the house and send him back to Rachel, who would sing more songs and tell more stories. And when Thomas would come in, she'd say, what are you doing out there? Oh, just this and that, he said. Well, we're going to be eaten by a bear if you stay out there all night long. Well, he wasn't just fiddling around, you know. He was figuring out how to make this guitar thing happen. And he was out there on a night that everyone was inside, everyone was finally asleep, and out of the dead of a starless night, the most horrendous scream comes. Thomas goes running in. Rachel's at her wit's end. Her eyes are open. She's got rags. She's going this way and that way, and a muskrat has fallen through the ceiling. Rachel had not yet learned how to use a rifle, because if she had, it was Thomas she would have shot that night. His job was to get the varmint out. Moses come, Juba May down. And Thomas put them all back in their bed, laid with them. And he looked at these precious children who he was going to take to a new place where they could live and be free and be peaceful, and the beautiful soft brown hair of his beloved caressed his cheek, and he cared so much for them. And as soon as he could feel them slipping into sleep, he slid back to to the shop where he was polishing and polishing, and the grain was getting finer and finer, and he wanted to put another coat on it. And just as he was out there, another scream erupted, and Rachel was scared because this scream came from Juba May. And Rachel wasn't quite yet ready to have this child come in. She thought Juba May might scream this child right out. Thomas took one look and went to get Ms. McGee, and they made a clean pallet on the floor for Juba May. And Moses played his strum, which is what every woman wants while she's having a baby. Haven't you just always heard, we need a banjo in the delivery room? But there he was, and doing his part. Everyone was doing their part. Juba May was doing her part. Moses was playing, and they pushed, and they pushed. And when the first light of day came through their open ceiling, a free child was born. McGee got his fiddle. But he played a softer lullaby. Moses hummed and strummed. The baby was asleep. Rachel and Thomas's children sat kind of close looking at this new creature. And Rachel took her fingers, playing her ghost. But this time, Thomas slid in her lap a maple guitar and wrapped her fingers around a long neck that Moses had turned frets with ivory keys, and a maple soundboard from the harpsichord. And she didn't quite know what it was, but when she ran her fingers, it was a sweet sound, a softer sound than the harpsichord. "Play, Mama, play," Christopher said. And she played. She played till spring. She played in the wagon as they climbed up toward the Cumberland Mountains. She played as they cut over from Big Lick and went up into Franklin County. And when Thomas settled them all in the Blue Ridge Mountains, Christopher learned to play the guitar too. While Thomas built them a home, full of love, full of stories, full of songs that passed from one generation to the next, like gestures, effortlessly go from generation to generation.
This guitar came from a timber, from the body of a tree, through the workshop of a luthier. Now it's on loan to me, and it's good company after dinner, and it fits my hands just fine. But someday another singer with a pair of hands like mine will coax out songs much prettier, still hiding in its strings, and sing stronger, braver words than I could ever sing. Folks are gonna love it, of this I'm almost sure. So I'll take good care of it, 'cause I'm borrowing it from her. Pass it along, pass it along. May it land in careful hands when we're gone. You carry it for a moment, time won't loan it to you for long. You don't own it, pass it along. And I still love my country. Sometimes it's hard to recognize it, but I count myself lucky to have been born inside it. And I'm grateful for the rights others struggled hard to win. You can be sure I'm gonna fight when they try and take them back again. Oh, and everywhere are teachers, though some fell along the way. The words they said still reach us, just like you're teaching me here today. And you may not speak it loud, but it's clear in what you do. And I hope to make you proud, 'cause I borrowed it from you. Pass it along, pass it along. May it land in careful hands when we're gone. Carry it for a moment, but time won't loan it to you for long. You don't own it, pass it along. Seems these days we're in a hurry to grab up all that's left to use, putting patents on discovery, making seeds that don't reproduce. If our vision is so narrow, seeing only body and soul, we'll end up like the pharaohs, buried with their gold. We've all pushed this thing along, we've all been guided by our fear. But the river sings a song, we've got to be quieter to hear. It's in every child's face, new and hopeful as a stem. Best be gentle with this place, 'cause we're borrowing it from them. Pass it along, pass it along. May it land in careful hands when we're gone. You carry it for a moment, time won't loan it to you for long. You don't own it, pass it along. I know you can sing. Pass it along, pass it along. May it land in careful hands when we're gone. You carry it for a moment, but time won't loan it to you for long. You don't own it, pass it along.